We're back. This is In Our Morning Show. And while it may seem as if things are back to normal, you know, with people back out to work and the bars are open and schools just, you know, you're starting to get ready for school in September, we continue to live in the new normal. I think most people are thinking still about when a vaccine would become available so we can return to some level of normalcy around the world. And if that is even possible, I'm not even sure. Well, there is a new COVAX facility, which is part of a global effort to support the production of vaccines if and when they become available. And on the line, I have Dr. Erica Wheeler, who is, of course, a WHO PAHO representative for Trinidad and Tobago and the Dutch Kingdom Islands. Good morning, Dr. Wheeler.
Good morning. Hi, Lisa. How are you today?
I am really looking forward to hear. I'm great. I'm wonderful. And I'm looking forward to hear about this new COVAX facility. And as we move forward towards a vaccine, possibly, what is this new COVAX facility, Dr. Wheeler?
Okay, so let us cast our minds back to May this year. There was a big push from WHO, who teamed up with the European Union, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the Gavi Alliance, several others, to look into the possibility of how do we advance, how do we do something different to advance the whole process of developing a vaccine. So they raised $7.4 billion. I think it maybe went up to $8 billion. Mm-hmm. And they established what's called the COVAX facility, is really a short for COVID-19 vaccine facility. Mm-hmm. And the idea behind it, let me read it so I don't get it wrong, is to develop the largest and most diverse actively managed portfolio of vaccine candidates, so that the best vaccines are made available and the world has access to the best science. So the idea behind it is right now there are 9 front runners in this COVAX facility. As I said, it is a consortium. It is something global. So it's not restricted only to certain countries like richer countries. Mm-hmm. So it is a facility to make sure that everyone across the world, all countries across the world, have access to any vaccines that may be produced. I noticed you carefully said if and when.
Yes.
Which is true. There are 9 candidates, and the facility is meant to provide access to all countries.
So when you said there are 9 front runners, what does that mean exactly?
Okay, so what it means is that at one point in time, there was something like 209 potential vaccines. Right now, 9 candidates have been identified, meaning they have reached a certain stage of clinical trials, okay? Mm-hmm. In different countries of the world, UK, Germany, China, Australia, USA. And the manufacturers there of the vaccines, they are the most advanced ones. So what has happened is something like $2 billion has already been invested in the production of these vaccines. So they're doing this totally differently from how they have ever done it before. Normally, it would take years, as I know you mentioned before, and you understand, to produce a vaccine. And they would wait until one becomes available, and then they will produce many doses. And then they'll wait maybe possibly until another one, or they may invest all the money in this one manufacturer. And what is possible is that a rich country can come along and buy up most of the vaccine. But this facility is meant to protect the world. So the money that is going to be sunk into the production of these vaccines, not all of them would probably be successful. In fact, the likelihood is that there may only be 2 or 3 that may be successful. Mm-hmm. But they've already, the consortium, this global COVAX facility, has already been investing in the clinical trials, so that as soon as any one of those 9 candidates become successful, or maybe more, mm-hmm. there will be production of vaccines. So the aim would be, if it's done next year, if it's successful next year, to produce starting with as many as 2 billion vaccines. This is how radically different it is.
And let's dial back a bit and talk about the testing of these vaccines now. How would that roll out? Because I know there was a bit of controversy in terms of where they'll be tested, which part of the world, and so on.
So for clinical trials, you know, you start really small with the testing of vaccines and you ramp it up. So when you invite people to be part of clinical trials, it's something they sign on to. They start with animals first, and then you move to humans, and then you start with a small number, and then you ramp it up to thousands. So it is a process step by step. But I know that we have heard a lot of strange stories, but persons actually volunteer to be part of clinical trials. It's what happens even with treatments, not only with vaccines. It happens with treatments as well, that people volunteer to be part of clinical trials. And we hear all kinds of stories, but don't always believe what you hear. Because remember, in the end, unless they're human volunteers, you can never be sure that the vaccine will be not just efficacious, but safe. So we need a sufficient number of persons to be part of these clinical trials. They're not forced against their will.
And Dr. Wheeler, what does this mean in terms of access? You said that, you know, it means that a rich country couldn't come and buy up all the vaccines. But in terms of prioritizing who gets what first and the amount that countries get, how do you anticipate this working?
Okay, so that is something that was also laid out, because yes, there's a very real possibility that rich countries can come along and buy it up if it was under the normal circumstances. But under this COVAX facility, they will not sell outside of the number of persons who have signed up to be part of this facility. So for example, in the region of the Americas, PAHO has stepped out and said, all the countries who want to be part of this facility, they sign up. We have something called the Revolving Fund, that's WHO and PAHO. And once a member state says, yes, I want to be part of the COVAX facility, the COVAX facility will not sell vaccines first to any country outside of the COVAX facility. So you would imagine that all countries will want to join. We have to wait and see. But it is a case of preferential treatment. So just a little bit, let me read you the allocation and the framework of the allocation mechanism. Mm-hmm. So essentially, there are priorities for receiving the vaccine. Health and social care workers are priority, and all countries will receive a first dose of 3% of the population, and that would be followed by high-risk adults in the population. So all countries will receive an additional set of doses to cover 20% of their population in tranches, and then further priority groups. So the protection is, it doesn't matter how big you are, how small you are, what's the size of your population. Once you are part of the COVAX facility, you have direct access and preference, because it is something global. It is not one country competing with another country or one manufacturer competing with another manufacturer. They've all agreed to work together in this global effort for the very first time.
For the very first time. And just to clarify, Trinidad and Tobago is part of the COVAX facility.
Yes, I am very happy to say that yesterday Trinidad and Tobago has indicated that they want to be part of the COVAX facility. So we are in.
That's wonderful news there, Dr. Wheeler. And we'll keep chatting with you as we move forward, as we call it, the race to a vaccine. Thank you so much, Dr. Wheeler, for once again joining us and bringing us up to date. Dr. Erica Wheeler there, country representative for Trinidad and Tobago and the Dutch Kingdom Islands for the World Health Organization and PAHO.